The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Let's just pray this morning. I just feel like God's going to give us a new challenge in the days ahead. He certainly challenged Jennifer and I. And today's message is basically, we're titling it Training for Reigning. However, I do believe in the future, it's going to be part and parcel of a love challenge. How many have heard the statement of people that have had a visitation, went to heaven, and the Lord said, how much? I've heard several people, not just Bob Jones, but there was other people too, that had a vision, and God's basically, they said, even without a question, just the impression in that heavenly sphere was, how much did you love with your life? And so I'm feeling that what God is going to begin to unveil is really going to be a love challenge, because I believe in these times there's going to be a clear distinction in the church. And where we move to another level. Here's the three levels. I repeat myself until I hear my people saying it back to me. So if you don't want to hear this again, start saying it back to me and I will move on. But here's the three truths that the church has in general acknowledged: the fact that God is for you. Say that back to me. God is for me. All right. However, the day's got to come when you're so confident that he is for you that you live with an implicit trust in him. And that's the only way you want to live. And when you say, don't ever say it in this church, that I'm having a difficult time trusting God. Because what you're basically saying is I'm trusting in self. And the prince of the power of the air actually controls you, self. So you don't ever want to say that. Not to me anyway. Cursed is the man that trusts in man. Well, that means if you trust in yourself, it's the same thing. It's not a good place to live, is it? You want to live under the blessing. Now, in training for reigning, I believe that God is going to take us into a third dimension. The first dimension is a revelation that God is for us. I mean, you've got to know that. That needs to be part and parcel of your Christian makeup. God is for you. Our entire message, as a matter of fact, every book we've ever published is to emphasize the second level or the second truth. And that second truth is basically that it's God in you. He is not only for you, he is in you. And if you look at our books, it's all on bringing the church to a closer, intimate relationship with God and recognizing that it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. And remember when we said that we used to travel and we would quote that scripture and we'd say, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Real quick now, everybody point. Where's Jesus? And 98% would point to the sky. There's a distance deception that's got to be eliminated. We've got to become more God inside minded, more God indwelt. And all of our material has for decades been with that primary purpose, to get people to walk and practice the presence of God 24/7, to be able to walk in a significant way to where heaven is on earth through you. Now, the third level, God is not only for you, God is not only in you, but I believe that we're going to see in the days ahead an outpouring of God, and the revelation that's going to be brought to the church is going to be God through you. It's going to be the replaced life. It's going to be basically, apart from him, you can do nothing. Many of these scriptures you know, but we need to bring some of these scriptures that we know into present tense reality. That's where the challenge is. And for that present tense reality to live in a replaced life, it's going to be that God can get through me. It's going to be the time and the season of the greater works. It's going to be the things that God's going to do through us, but it's basically a selfless life. And it's not just dealing with sin, but it's dealing with self. And I believe the how-tos are going to be necessary no matter what level of spiritual maturity we enter into. We're still going to need to know how to deal with the environment around us. And so today's message is training for reigning. And I believe that what scripture we cover today is to bring it into the forefront of practical Christian living now, today. Endeavor to say, I need to know how to do that. And of course, we are the how-to people, so to speak. And I believe that God has given some keys on how to practice scriptures that you can quote. Quoting them is wonderful. Living them is another thing, isn't it? Well, here's the one that I believe we're going to learn today, and that I'm going to eventually develop a love challenge so that Christians can have a practical way to see how much am I loving with my life. In other words, I know I'm supposed to, but how do I tell where I'm at and where I need improvement? Okay, so here's the scripture. This is the challenge. Romans 5:17, particularly in the Amplified translation, it says, for if because of one man's trespass, death reigned. What reigned? Death reigned. Through that one, how much more surely will those who receive God's overflowing grace and the free gift of righteousness reign as kings in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Reigning in life as king. What does that really mean? It can't just be something you quote. And in all of our emphasis on walking in the realm of Jesus in you, one of the things that I noticed was part of what needs to be changed and transformed in the church is we're very good at proclamation, decreeing, and declaring, correct? We're good at prophesying, decree, declare. But I'm saying the weakness, even in that declaration, is in an absence of knowing really what the source is that it's coming from. There has been a lack of truly walking in Him. And so, therefore, all of our emphasis for years has been, for decades, literally, to bring the body back to say, before the next thing, let's see God bring these former things and get them so well established in our life that we're building on a foundation going from faith to faith, from glory to glory, from victory to victory, and not just be totally confused by what's going on. So here are some keys that I believe was sharing with a major Christian leader, and I was talking about discernment, discerning of spirits, recognizing the nuances, recognizing the different flavors of both good and evil. You know, good and evil both have flavors. You know, if you look in your Bible, there's a hasty spirit, there's a humble spirit. It's not just good or evil, it's a certain kind of good and a certain kind of evil. Well, his word to describe it all was flow. And I said, yeah, in a generic way, that's the way we would probably learn it in charismatic circles, right? You want to understand flow. And it's like a river. However, in this spiritual life, it flows. One of the things our friend Bill Morford did in his translation of the One New Man Bible, that really out of that beautiful work that he did, the thing that touched my heart more than anything was he marveled at how our English language misses in the translation the word continuously. And I, by the way, I think that's our next book in 2017. I don't know what the title be for them, but the context that we have so far is that basically the will of God is a river. It's not just a place or a plan. It's not just some kind of a rigid structure. It is something that flows. And so to understand flow would be the way to train for reigning, wouldn't it? Reigning is as kings in life. And remember, He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So this is part of our destiny, isn't it? We were predestined to rule and reign as kings. Even in Genesis, it basically said, you know, for this purpose, to have dominion over the fish of the sea. Dominion and to reign as kings, but these kings must be under authority before they have any authority. This is not about rugged individualism or independence. This is about a radical dependence. We used to say, when you say I do to the Lord, memorize that I do, just like your wedding vow. You're the part of the bride of Christ. Remember your wedding vow. I do. Intimacy, dependency, and obedience. Isn't that a good way to remember it? Intimacy, dependency, and obedience. Not independence, dependency. You get more dependent as you mature in the Lord, not less. All right? So, we want to learn about this spiritual flow. We want it to be consistently constant. We want it to be a continual flow. Just like William Morford said in his One New Man translation, that it's not just ask, seek, knock. It's ask and keep on asking, seek and keep on seeking, repent and keep on repenting, forgive and keep on forgiving. Well, how do you do that? By much repetition and much talking? No, by living in the flow of it. You walk in the light as he is in the light, and the blood cleanses you. It's a river. It's a flow. It's not a constant repetition of words, decrees, declarations, and pronouncements, and memorized scripture. All of those things are wonderful, but it needs to come out of the flow first, the source, the source. A river needs to be the river that you want, or the river of God. There is a river that makes glad the city of God. Its source is in God. Any other river, you don't need to get in that flow. I always loved it when God gave me my vision for my first pastorate, and one of the scriptures he used was Ezekiel 47, and he showed me that from the base of the temple, and he meant in a corporate assembly, of course, but I saw it right here. What about the base of this temple? That out of my belly would flow rivers, and wherever those rivers flowed, there would bring forth life. Do you believe that? Do you believe that out of my belly flows rivers? Out of your belly flows rivers? So don't be crying out to heaven all the time when you've got heaven in you. That's a paradigm shift that must be taken. But I want to get you ready for the next paradigm shift. The next paradigm shift is even after you've gotten comfortable with Christ in you, even when you get comfortable with the idea of flow and practicing the presence 24/7, I want you to get uncomfortable for a little while and readjust to the fact that you begin to allow God to work through you. It's like Jennifer had that vision once when she was a young believer. She said she saw Jesus facing her and coming, and it's like she could put her hands out and touch his hands. And then all of a sudden, he came around and was in her, and she was looking through his eyes and from his heart. That's a replaced life. That's what God's love. You want to reign as kings. You have to be in that realm where he's king. If he's not king, you're not operating in any kind of real authority, no matter what your proclamation, no matter what your decree, no matter what your prophecy, your preaching is. My goodness, I'll tell you what, flow needs to be understood at the source. Any river that's going to produce life has to have the proper source, doesn't it? And so out of my belly flows rivers. You know, God basically said that whatever you drink, remember the woman at the well, whoever drinks of this water I will give him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. I will extend my peace, my supernatural shalom, like a river, and the glory of the nations like an overflowing stream. Everything will live wherever the river goes, Ezekiel 47. And it's like, this was not a choppy walk. This was not a plan structured like some kind of a business model. It was basically, let me live my life through you, and you let the peace of God rule. As a matter of fact, how many have memorized that scripture? Let the peace that surpasses all understanding guard your heart and your mind. How about trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding. Yeah, everybody's nodding their head. You know this, but do you live this? Here's how you would have to live this. Trust in the Lord. Here's where you trust down here, by yielding and surrendering to his lordship. Your mind, will, and emotions is now comfortably subordinate to his lordship. All three are under his authority, and peace is ruling in your spirit. I'm trusting in the Lord, and am I trusting with all my heart? Yes, everything is under and subordinate. And how do I know it's subordinate? The peace of God is ruling. Let the peace of God rule. Jesus is ruling. Okay, trust in the Lord with all my heart. All my heart's there. I've got peace. And it says, acknowledge him. Oh, what's it say first? The trap, the thing that hinders flow. Lean not on your understanding. Isn't that interesting that in the midst of everything good happening down in your spirit, he has to, right in the middle of telling you all the good stuff, he does, oh, by the way, lean not on your own understanding, but in, look where I'm at, all of your ways, I will direct your path. All of that comes from your spirit, not your head. The only thing about the head that was mentioned in that scripture was the warning, don't lean on your own understanding. Don't try to figure it out. Follow flow. If you can follow flow, I'll tell you what, you'll always be in the right place at the right time. You'll never go wrong. Isn't that beautiful? Now, that's basically spiritual life that is like a flow. Here's the way I would train people for that level, for that third level. There's going to be opportunity for all of us to grow no matter what level you're in. But if this paradigm shifts, then you're real comfortable being with God indwelt and practicing his presence, then you want to reign as kings in life, all of life. That's regardless of circumstances. To reign means that you're under the jurisdiction of his lordship. You are an under king to the King of Kings. You're walking in dominion as a lord, but you are under lordship. No lordship or kingliness apart from him. All right? So, step number one. The first step in living with flow is you're going to have to know how to receive. Something as simple as that. I've watched and done altar ministry for years, and so have many of you. I saw that there were people who didn't know how to receive. They could come up and be sincere in their head and not know how to open their heart, not know that you receive here, not here. This can listen to what's being said, but this determines the source of what's being said. If you can't listen from down here, you don't know how to receive. Some don't even know that this is where you receive, yet alone how you receive. They've been busy trying to get it up here so they can cram it down to their spirit, and that doesn't work. Matter of fact, anything good you have by revelation, probably you got it by accident. You accidentally did it right from the heart and didn't know it. I don't want to do it by accident. I want to do it on purpose. And to do it on purpose, I'm going to learn to live out of here. Live from the, this is the epicenter. I believe your spirit man fills you from head to toe. But this is the door. This is the epicenter. This is where the conscience is. This is the seat of the emotions. This is everything good's gonna or bad is gonna happen down here. So pay attention. You're going to have to get out of your head and into your heart and learn to pay attention. You give power to what you give attention to, and if you don't start giving attention to your spirit, you're not gonna know. The soulish man doesn't understand. You know what that means? He can't even make a good decision. If he doesn't understand, he doesn't know what to accept or what to reject. He's just like a ship without a rudder, just tossed to and fro, trying to figure everything out. And the thing that I want to see more than anything, at least in our churches, and the people that we have contact with, don't ever come to me and tell me how proud you are of your mind. Well, I'm a head person. Well, don't be proud of it. Humble yourself. It isn't about IQ, it's EQ. Your EQ is more important than your IQ. Your emotional quotient is more important than your IQ. Your IQ might be getting you in trouble. Some of the smartest people have done some of the dumbest things. If that brain of yours isn't under the isn't comfortably subordinate under Jesus, it's not worth much. It's dangerous. If the heart is crooked and you've got a high IQ, you'd just be a smarter crook. If that's what you want to be. Yeah. Many will aspire to be a politician so that they can do. Be a smarter crook. If the heart is crooked, so goes the person. All right, now, so element, there's seven elements, I believe, that we're going to bring you into a place of training for reigning. But here's what I want you to pay attention to. Not just knowing what has to be learned, learn what will hinder it. Because I believe my Jesus walks through walls, and all of us have walls in these seven areas. Area number one, in receiving, I believe that God even introduced for a season, kind of a catch-up, soaking. How many are familiar with soaking? I saw some people soak and never did anything else but soak. All right? Soaking was basically a catch-up move to teach you how to receive, because you weren't sitting still long enough. You didn't know how to be still and know that He was God. You thought everything was activity. Everything was gifting. Everything was being in constant motion, even though you weren't in the river. The failure to receive, which means you're not flowing, you can have gifts without substance. Doesn't mean you're flowing. But here's the problem I saw in receiving. There was four elements, and we did this. We basically used to take notes because we'd be ministering to multitudes of people, and when we saw a similar pattern, we wrote it down. Because what was easy for me was not necessarily easy for the people we were ministering to. And there's things you can do that's not it's easy for you, but it's not necessarily easy for somebody else. They need how-tos then, don't they? If you are going to help equip them. So here's the four things that we saw wrong with receiving. Number one, they didn't know where or how you receive. They didn't know that it's from down here in the heart. They were trying so desperately to do everything and learn everything they could in their head. So they didn't know how or where you receive. That was point one. The second one was they couldn't differentiate between giving and receiving. Have you ever prayed for somebody and you felt like this is a time for an impartation, and you want to pray, you feel the anointing of God, and you want to pray for them, and what are they doing? They're going, they're in give mode when you're trying to get receive. They're not going to receive nothing. They're too busy pouring out. Something as simple as that, but it's commonplace. And when you see that pattern often enough, you know that person has difficulty seeing. Or they're busy begging for it to where they don't stop begging in order to receive it. Like, when are you going to take this? Oh, Jesus, oh, God, oh, my Jesus, oh, God, I used to hear. And then I used to get a bad witness on that because some of that was learned behavior and it was fake crying. Don't do fake crying. If you really cry, then cry your heart out. But don't do... You're not being heard and you're not receiving anything more just because you're doing that. You saw somebody else do it and you thought it was cool. Well, it's not. All right. So first, they didn't know where or how to forgive. Or receive. Secondly, they failed to differentiate between giving and receiving. And third, and this even happened to Jesus, they basically failed to honor the vessel that's coming with the message. You had a bias. You were looking at the personality. You couldn't hear what they stood for or the message they were to deliver because you were judging them by outward appearance. Christians, you know how many times I've heard that with this coming election? Going by appearance? I'm not voting for anybody. Well, then you're pro-abortion, are you? Because that's what you're doing by default when you say, I am not exercising my right to vote. You should be voting a Christian platform, shouldn't you? Yeah. Right? So that sitting out is an arrogance that is, to me, remarkably arrogant because you're basing it on a personality. I tell you, we had some generals during World War II that didn't have very nice personalities, but they got the job done, didn't they?
Yeah. Right.
If I came home and there was, I heard this one lady say this, if I came home from vacation and there were raccoons in my basement, I'd want to hire somebody that knew how to get raccoons out of my basement. I don't care if they had bad breath, didn't shave, and dressed poorly. If they got the raccoons out of the basement, right? So, failed to honor the vessel. Just think, Jesus, the most anointed man that ever walked the face of the earth couldn't do much because they didn't honor the vessel. They didn't know how to receive from him because of their prejudice and their bias. Isn't that something? Don't make the same mistake. If you're going to reign as kings in life, you're going to have to die to that. You're going to have to die to judging. To really discern, you have to die to judging. Because then discernment will be identifying the source, not your opinion. Your opinion can color the source to where you don't know what the source is. You don't know if it's good or evil because you're too opinionated. So God's basically saying when you fail to honor the vessel, you're going to fail in the area of receiving. And the fourth level, this one kind of broke my heart. When we traveled, every now and then a pastor would ask if we would help with a particular individual that was, you know, severely troubled. We saw severely troubled people change like that gloriously. We saw severely people troubled because of this last area. Very, very, very inadequate level of consecration. You know what that means? I don't want to read my Bible. I don't want to pray. I don't want to do anything on my part. I want you to come, lay hands on me, and I'm better. Poor consecration is an inhibition to receiving. So I don't know. Is this helping? It's one thing to know where to receive and how to receive, but to me, it's helpful to know where is the receiving failing in the body of Christ. Am I doing any of these things? Because if I am, I'm going to do Bob Newhart's counseling method. You know what Bob Newhart's counseling method was? Stop it. He used to charge for that, $5. Stop it. The lady said she was afraid of being confined. And he said, stop it. And she said, but you don't understand. It's been like this for a long time. Stop it. She kept on going on and on. But you don't understand. I don't like to be confined. And I have these visions. He goes, look, lady, I'm going to put you in a box. And I'm going to confine you in this little box until you stop it. She stopped it. She left. She paid her $5. All right. So we're going to have to quit some of these things. Anybody recognize anything in receiving that you could do better? Receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you receive a prophet's reward. By the same token, your inability to receive from a particular type of personality or outward appearance can keep you from receiving the reward. You could lose your reward. You could lose what you could have received from them. Second element, after you learn to receive, to learn to understand flow, you've got to understand forgiveness comes from the heart. Unless you forgive from the heart, Matthew 18, it's simple enough, but you'd be surprised how many people have struggled for years. And when we travel, we saw the same pattern that we taught it over and over again. Matter of fact, some people, that's the only thing they ever heard we said. They go, Dennis and Jennifer Clark, yeah, that's the forgiveness people. Well, if they got that, that could have changed their life. Because if you try to forgive from here, nothing's going to happen. It has to come from the heart. And we have to teach people that you allow flow. Remember, like a fountain? What does a fountain mean? What does a stream mean? Out of my belly flows. What does that mean? Do you have to make it flow? No. It's just something that happens. What you need to do is get out of the way. Open the door. Open the floodgate of your heart. And it flows. It is God who is at work to will and to perform. Let him perform. Quit performing. Quit trying. Trying is not trusting. So forgiveness, for me, was a river that flowed constantly. Unforgiveness was something stopping the flow. It was that simple. I was a baby Christian, and I knew that forgiveness came from here. And I knew that I didn't have to confess it, prophesy it, and decree and declare it. I know you're used to that, but I didn't have to do that. All I knew is that I would be praying and enjoying sweet communion right here. And the minute I would picture someone like my foreman in my head, I would feel yuck down here. I would let Jesus in me take that yuck. Jesus is the forgiver. I would surrender it to him until I could picture that foreman and feel peace here. What does it mean if I can picture that foreman here and I feel peace here? Not only am I, if I forgiven him thoroughly, I have a testimony. Peace means Jesus is ruling in that situation. There's all kinds of nonsense we used to hear, right? We used to hear things like sincere people trying to forgive from their head. We saw belief that you can forgive, but you should live with the pain. Oh, that's taught. We're not talking about in a corner here somewhere. Because when you don't know how to do it properly, that's the kind of theology you come up with. Forgiveness and repentance removes the pain. It removes the barrier. Forgiveness is Jesus walking through the wall. He takes your pain and your sorrow instantly. And that's the other thing we hear. Well, it's hard. It's hard because it was hard for you. Don't develop your theology just because you were doing it wrong or intermittently doing it right, and then therefore coming to a conclusion that it's hard. Emotional healing for the average believer should be as easy as breathing. If it's not, you're in your head. Because Jesus takes the pain and the sorrow. He's the forgiver. Allow him to flow. Is that different than trying? Yeah. Let him flow. Allow. How do you allow someone to take it? You drop down your spirit and you open the door. Is that too simple? Because it is. Would you rather make it hard and struggle with it? You can. You can get back up in your head and go, I don't know. After all I've been through all these years and now you're telling me it's easy, I feel like I wasted all those years. Yeah, you did. But the good news is God can restore the years the locust has eaten. So you want to live in regret? Forgiving removes barriers, and it is a flow from the heart. The failure in forgiveness was trying to do it from the head, but to believe that you're going to forgive, but just live with the pain. That's mental. That's mental assent. That's all that is. And last, believe that forgiveness is a process because I've got such a messed up life. There must be layers upon layers upon layers. We always heard the onion story from people. There's got to be layers and layers and layers. Well, you are really bad then. You must have lots of layers. But guess what? God walks through walls. He don't care if it's this thick or that thick or this thick. There's no big or little for Jesus. Big or little is something you came up with. Jesus said, is it easier for me to say, take up your bed and walk, or your sins are forgiven? Now, for us, there would be a difference, wouldn't there? Huh? But for him, it's the same, and he lives in you. Let him treat it as the same. Love it. That's element number two. What is number one? Learning how to receive, learning what the barriers are to receive. You're going to reign in this life. You're going to have to learn how to do this. It's not theory, it's practice. And practice will make this permanent. Secondly, understanding forgiveness, where you forgive from, how to forgive, and it's easy. Watch out for the lies about forgiveness. Element number three, loving. And I'm saying this should be called the love challenge. Because in the days ahead, if you master these principles, or you're at least aware of these principles, you will go from unconsciously incompetent to consciously incompetent. That's a step up. That's called improvement. You didn't know you were so bad. We had a Nashville singer did a song for us when she did our first module, April, remember? She says, Brand New was the name of the song. She goes, she went to our module and she says, I realized I was broken and I didn't even know it. There's people that are broken don't even know it. But Jesus puts it back together and just like a broken wing on a bird, it's stronger than before. Remember, I met with Janie Grine one time during a transitional period in my life, and she was telling me that she did that song Stronger Than Before, but everybody calls it the broken wing song. Because we're just so prone to being what's wrong as opposed to the redemptive part of what's right. Stronger Than Before was the name of the song, but everybody called it the broken wing song. But a broken wing, a bird's wing, when it's broken and it's healed, is stronger than it was before. So it's like, God, we need to start recognizing we're going to reign as kings in life, right? The third element is the loving flow. Love needs an object. Faith works by love, all right? Remember, Kenneth Copeland used to say, love is the mother of faith. That makes sense. Faith works by love. It's coming from the love of God, all right? But this is the way I want to challenge the believers in the days ahead, the love challenge. We're calling this reigning as kings, but it's really going to be the love challenge eventually, all right? Practice holding the door of your heart open. Make sure the camera gets this. And walk like Mr. Magoo. How many of you ever saw the cartoon figure Mr. Magoo? Little guy, he couldn't see where he's going, but he just come out smelling like a rose. That's what you would happen in your life if you just open the door of your heart and let love flow indiscriminately all through the day. This is effortless, but it requires focus or paying attention to the God inside and letting God be God. So you let love flow. All right. Now, what would stop the flow of love flowing? We used to have people, had a pastor once, he tried this out, he saw a crabby clerk in a store, and the clerk was being snippy with everybody in line. So he just got in the back of the line, and he just dropped down and said, I'll let the love of God flow to that. He wasn't saying it. He wasn't confessing it. He wasn't decreeing and declaring. He wasn't creating a lot of noise in the store. He just let the Spirit flow. It's an attitude of the heart. It's a disposition. God is at work to will. And Philippians 2:13, you need to have that practical, not something you quote, but something you live in. Philippians 2:13, it is God who is at work both, to will and to do. That means your job is to hold the door open. You hold the door open and you say, oh, but somebody might pick on me if I'm vulnerable. No, if you're open, love precedes peace. Peace will guard your heart and your mind. No junk will come in when you're walking in love. When there's a fire hose of love flowing out of you as a constant, junk doesn't come in. Junk comes in when, how do you stop the flow of love? Oh, there's that person that gave me a hard time. Ugh. You shut the door of your heart and think you're protecting yourself. That kind of carnality's got to go away. I would say 98% of the church still does that. Do you agree? You know what I'm talking about. You're in an unpleasant situation, a former boss that fired you or someone that dismissed you or ex-boyfriend, ex-girlfriend, and suddenly you see them and all of a sudden they show up and you go, uh-oh. You know what you just did? You, as an act of your carnal nature, you shut the door of your heart to that person. And you said, I might be forced to listen to what they have to say in my head, but my heart's closed off. Do you know what you also did? You shut Jesus out of the situation. You know what the little kids told us at Harvest Fest? It's not good to close the door on Jesus. Some of us need to pass the test of a third grader then, don't we? It's not good to close the door. Just because that person is volatile, this does not protect you, by the way. If they are evil or demonic and you did this, that evil will go right through that because self-protection does not guard your heart and your mind. Peace will guard your heart. Peace is supernatural. Peace is the armor of God, and the God of peace could crush the enemy beneath your feet. It's militant. All right? How are we doing on the love challenge so far? Do some of us feel like we need to go more in love? Yeah. You're guarding your heart a little too much? You're guarding yourself? Doesn't work. So love's failure is basically putting up the wall or Jonah, run. I'm walking down the aisle in Publix and there's that person that doesn't like me. How can the love of God be in you then, huh? What did you just do? You went the other way. That's not the love of God flowing out. How about if I didn't go the other way like Jonah and I didn't rebel? What about if I just put up a wall? They offended me. We're living in a culture where everybody's offended. Did you know that? I think some of them aren't even really offended. They just like saying it so that they get their way. I'm offended. Everybody's offended all of a sudden. It's like, what a bunch of sissies. I'm offended. I don't want to see the American flag. I'm offended. Then go to some country where they have a flag that you like. Go live somewhere else. Find a flag you like and go live there. I don't know. Silliness. I'm offended. I would say that would stop the flow of love, and you would probably not do well on the love challenge. How many are going to sign up for the love challenge? You're going to sign up for this? Okay. Make sure you take good notes, because these are the things, the obstacles that prevent the challenge from fruition. Now, so we covered the failures on loving. That's the third principle. The fourth principle. We even had cards made out for this fourth principle. Love is jubilee. Love means you've got to let it go. How many Christians are like a dog with a bone sometimes? Husbands or wives or friends will go, look, let it go. Have you ever had to say that to somebody? Let it go. You know what it means? It means that they're in control and they basically don't know how to jubilee. They don't know how to love. They don't know how to cancel the debt. But release would be, we even had cards printed up and used the Living Bible, hopefully so that it would sink in their head as well as their heart. Romans 14:4, it says, this is Living Bible translation, 1979 version. They are God's servants, not yours. They belong to Him, not to you. God is able to tell them whether they're right or wrong, and God is able to make them do as they should. Let it go, is what it's saying. They are God's servants, not yours. You know what the confusion is? You think you own them. Parents, you don't even own your children. They're God's servants, not yours. They belong to Him and not to you. And God is able to tell them whether they're right or wrong. And God is able to make them do as they should. I just hear the mothers right now saying, I disagree with that. If I don't tell them, it isn't going to happen. Well, you know what? You can tell them, but ultimately, that little runaway girl that's giving you so much problems, Mom, you can make her do it while she's in the house. And as soon as she gets outside that front door, she's going to do it her way. You can't be there. I would think you would be better off relinquishing her into the loving, capable hands of God. Do like we did. By golly, they got caught all the time. When you relinquish it to God, you release them. Now, that's not just people, Romans 14:4. That has to do with you as well. If you're going to walk and reign as kings in life, you have to say, I'm God's person, not mine. I belong to Him and not to me. And God is able to tell me whether I'm right or wrong, and God is able to make me do as I should. You think? And it also applies to stuff. You go into work and there's a pile on your desk. And some people don't know how to let it go. And they go into depression over it. You drop down and go, I release that into the loving, capable hands of God. I will fulfill my responsibility. I'll do the best I can as unto the Lord, not as to what man is demanding. And you know you honor God that way. You never lose honoring God. Honor God in those issues and learn to release stuff. Because if you demand it from people, you're just gonna stop the flow of love. And God's not in it. Okay? That's the fourth element. The fifth element, understanding biblical resistance. Remember we said before, the one that we understand the best resisting is putting up our wall. That comes easy. That's the flesh. Like, uh-oh, so-and-so's going to want me to do something, and I don't want to put up the wall. But in reality, what resisting is that if you would keep your heart, guard your heart, let peace of God guard your heart and your mind, guess what happens? When you let the peace of God guard your heart, then you're obeying the scripture that's in like Proverbs 4. Keep or guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. The love of God flows when you basically let peace guard your heart and your mind, not you guard your heart and your mind. I think you have to relinquish control here. I think we run as general manager of the universe a little too often. Jennifer tells me I only campaign occasionally now. I've relinquished that. Every now and then the Dennis Menace pops up and he wants to run things again. Then God has to remind who's Lord. But it's basically a failure to understand releasing is a failure to understand ownership versus stewardship. Parents, you're a steward of your children. You're not an owner. That's God's property, not yours. It belongs to Him and not to you. Isn't that something? Do you think we need to learn release? Because love releases. I can remember having little children and my first pastorate come to me, Pastor, I need an appointment. And they would come in for an appointment. Of course, the problem was always mother or father. But they'd come in and say, Pastor, I have a problem. I heard this one more than once. That's why I use this illustration. I want to help around the house. I want to do the dishes. I want to help my mother. But the way she says it, there is a push. What happens when your spirit feels a push or control? You rebel. Even if you would have wanted to. There's a tendency in the flesh to rebel against it. You could give the child the same instruction minus the push and get farther. You could speak the truth in love. I'm not saying you don't say nothing. I'm not saying you don't tell them to do the dishes. I'm telling you there's a way to ask them to do the dishes and a corresponding consequence if they disobey you and go in rebellion. But the point is love flowing out of your heart in the process, or are you just upset? Because there, no matter what your words are, mom and dad, the child's spirit picks up the motive and the source. The source, not the words. Like, I remember a friend of mine used to get punished by his dad all the time, and his dad would tell him the same thing, and he never quite got it. He goes, what did I do? What did I say? And his father would say, I gave you that spanking because of your attitude. And it never registered he had an attitude. It wasn't what you did or said, it's your attitude. Do you think God thinks like that with us? Sometimes we have to need an attitude adjustment? Well, that's possible. And if so, I believe that God's going to teach us how to release into the loving, capable hands of God and let the flow continue. So releasing is the fourth element. Releasing is like forgiving, except that it can be non-people. It can be things in life that you have to let it go. Still fulfill your responsibility, but let it go from the place of peace in your life. The fifth element, resisting. Oh, we said that already. Resisting. The failure for resisting, you know, we said, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. The failure in resisting properly is carnal walls or a closed heart. Closed heart, carnal walls. You can either put up the wall, or I remember praying, Jennifer, when we first got married. Remember, that was a real eye-opener for you, spiritually speaking. We prayed, and her father was abusive, bottom line, just being blunt. And I prayed Jennifer through a lot of releasing forgiveness for his abusive behavior, very domineering. And I mean, Jennifer would go in a 100-and-some-degree attic in Florida when he'd come home for lunch, just so she wouldn't have to listen to the lecture, which was more like an interrogation at lunchtime. And when I prayed her through some of these things, she would release forgiveness to her dad. And immediately after she forgave, she put up a wall like, but he's never going to get close again. And remember, we said, no, Jennifer, once you release, the only legitimate wall for a believer is peace. And it will guard your heart and your mind. The only legitimate wall is peace. And from the place of peace, you can even call the police. If some people are that rebellious that they need the law is good if it's used lawfully. From the place of peace, you don't take abuse. You call the police. From the place of peace, you'll make better decisions. If you're angry or upset, your decision-making will be unnecessarily harsh. Do you see the value of the Lordship of Jesus and the flow of love? Love does not mean you get beat up by people. Love does not mean that you take abuse. Love means that when you're in the process of loving and peace guards your heart and your mind, you'll make better decisions. And you'll understand consequences that are fair and just and safe and benefit all. For the law is just if it's used lawfully. And who's it for? The ones that don't want to abide by the law. Lawbreakers, right? So it's a form of the love of God. There's legal love to protect innocent people. Then there is the next level of love that we want to spend most of our time as believers, and that's redemptive love. Redemptive forgiveness, repentance, redemptive love. And then someday there's paradise love, where it'll be just all-encompassing forever. All right. The sixth element is ruling. And when the Lord basically showed me this, let's go back to resisting. Here's a good scripture verse for the failure to resist properly. It said, Jeremiah 2:13, "For my people have committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain, and they've found a substitute." So in other words, instead of letting the love of God flow out of the fountain, you've shut off to that fountain and say, in order to get that need met, you found a substitute to meet that need. Could be a person, place, or thing, but you found a substitute to meet that need. That will stop the flow of love. My people committed two evils. They forsook the fountain. They don't trust in me no more. They found something else as a substitute. Two sins. And that substitute is a broken cistern and it can't hold any water. You've literally turned from a fountain of freely flowing, living water for like a stagnant bird bath. That's a bad choice, isn't it? The sixth level is ruling. And when God basically says, apart from me, you can do nothing, we know that peace ruling is being ruled by peace. We know that that's the source of our authority. Let the peace of God rule. But the way the Lord taught it to me was, I think the church was introduced to decades ago soaking to get them to still their noisy flesh was the intent. But God took me, and that was the only way I knew prayer was communion. And when I would close my eyes and I would enjoy communion with God, what God said was, I knew my will was here, which that was revolutionary for a lot of the church. They think their will is here. All right? This is your will. This is the door of the heart. I learned that as I yielded to Jesus within, he showed me that like a cable, my will was like a bar, so to speak, where I took control, white-knuckled it. But it was like a bar at first, and I knew it was an open heart, so it was a door, it was a bar. But he said, when I yielded that bar of my will. He would wrap his supernatural will around it like a cable, and it would become a scepter of authority. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And the authority would be behind the words of your mouth and the declarations and the prophecy and the preaching and the teaching. He showed me that you need my authority as the source before you speak. In other words, you don't have anything to give unless you've received it from me. You haven't really got much to say until you've heard something. That was revolutionary. But I found out that where that all began was yielding my will like a bar to him to wrap his cable. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. It was a renewal of strength by wrapping the cable of his will around my will until what I exercised was basically yielding to his will. And it would have the necessary authority and the flow of love behind it. Now, that's the sixth element. The failure in understanding that rule would be, it's simple, no peace. Whenever, at any given moment, you do not have peace, he's not ruling. You may still be saved, but he's not ruling. Let the peace of God rule means Jesus is Lord. He might be your Savior, but he's not Lord when you don't have peace. There's no authority. And you probably are going through religious motions and you're busy and active. But that's not the same as Jesus ruling in your life. You can move in the gifts of the Spirit and not be under the lordship of Jesus. That's the rule. The seventh element, and this is where the test comes in, reigning. Ruling is having Jesus become Lord. Peace of God rules. But I believe God's going to bring us into the place of reigning as kings. The flow of love from the Lordship is God and others focused. It's a washing away. It's a ongoing flow. Remember we said a continuous flow, consistently constant flow. That while this is flowing, here's the way a replaced life is going to walk the Christian walk. If you sin, you have forgiveness walking it out. But you're going to learn that in walking in love and in the challenge of a love walk, while that's flowing out, temptations are going to come and it's going to go like that. Remember, Jesus was tempted yet without sin. So something had to come at you no matter how spiritual you are. Something, stuff will still come at you. The point is, can you see it coming at you and then let it go? Can you let the love of God flow out? Can you walk in a constant flow of the love of God that when a temptation comes, I'm not going there. From here, I'm not going there. That's guarding your heart, but it's more than guarding your heart. It's allowing the love of God to flow and reign supreme in your life, to reign as kings through the man, Christ Jesus. It's a replaced life. He's living through you. How's he doing it? From the Spirit, not your head. And you allow the door to remain open, even in times of temptation. Doesn't mean you suck the temptation in. That means you got something to forgive and repent of. But you basically, the flow is so real, you go, I ain't going there. How would you like to get spontaneous? Then you would have a sensitive conscience, not a remorse conscience. How many know the difference? A sensitive conscience is you get the signal before you do anything wrong. Like, oh, you don't want to do that, Dennis. Compared to a remorse conscience, it's always guilty and repenting. Because it's after the fact that you get guilty and ashamed. Now, if you're going to reign, this is part that I'm going to repeat until I have my people repeating back to me. There's a conflict that's going to come to the church, and I can see it scripturally between 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. The natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit, for they are foolishness to him, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual discerns all things. It's going to be a conflict because it's not going to be how much Bible you know. It's going to come into a spiritual realm of reality to where if you live in your head and you're just a mental Christian who knows the Bible inside out and backwards, it says you are not going to understand. The soulish mental man does not understand. If you don't understand, how can you possibly respond in a way that would be pleasing to God? You don't even know what to accept or reject because you don't understand. If you don't understand, you don't know how to discern. You can't discern till you understand. This is good. This is evil. This is right. This is wrong. This is holy. This is unclean. Awareness of the spirit world is going to have to be mandatory. Every great awakening, there was a battle in Christendom with the head people versus the people that were entering into spiritual experience. It's not going to change. The same thing's going to happen. And the head people just love to argue. But you don't see the changed lives. God's looking for changed lives. The failure to reigning would be owning the environment. Boy. This has been a soapbox now for decades for us. Teaching people that if you're in a negative environment, it doesn't have to evangelize you. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. The flow of God's love should be coming out of you to where I don't care if there's 10 angry people, greater is he that's in you than those 10 angry people. If you're getting irritated and angry, they are spiritually evangelizing you. That's got to stop. And then you murmur and complain, and we know how God loves that, all right? Just like in the wilderness. And they're all angry, God. I can't stand working here because they're all angry. Well, you're no different than they are then. Well, you are. You should know better. They are without God, apart from a covenant. Their understanding is darkened, but you don't have to act like that. Here's the key. You cannot be, if you're a note taker, just write this down. And if you skip all of your other notes and you endeavor to do this, you'll be in great shape. You cannot be more spiritual than your emotions allow you. We don't even talk about emotions in the church. Well, you're doing this church. You cannot be more spiritual than your emotions allow you. The emotions are necessary for the rule of God. The emotions are necessary for demonic activity to torment you. Good or evil, the emotions are necessary. Jennifer said the latest breakthrough in science even corroborates it. Emocognition, emovolition. The emotions control your thinking. The emotions control your choices. And we still, after you hear this, you'll still go back and you'll decree, declare, and try to make everything happen with your mouth without paying attention to where is it coming from. Isn't that true? Is that a possibility? Because we learn it that way. I'm saying if you're not paying attention to the source, you might just be saying empty words. Good scriptural words. Can the devil quote scripture? And I'm going to give this other example, and I'm going to say it until people start telling me this back. I saw that thing on Facebook. It's not your best source of information. But they had people trying to imitate the shepherd to a bunch of dumb sheep. And sheep are dumb. They really are. It's one of the only animals that needs to be cared for. They can't do well on their own, or so I'm told. All right? Everybody tried to fake being the shepherd, and those sheep wouldn't even pick up their... They weren't even curious. And I'm thinking, what a testimony to the body of Christ. They weren't even curious. Christians will listen even if it's gossip. They go, oh, yeah, that's a good one. They weren't even curious. But when the shepherd's voice came, they not only lifted up their heads simultaneously, they came running toward the shepherd. The nature that was on the voice, not the words. They recognized his voice. My sheep know my voice, John 10:27. That's what God says. You're supposed to know the nature. If you don't get spiritual enough to know the nature that's on words, you won't know when you're getting a prophetic word from the flesh or when you're getting it from the Spirit. You need to know the nature that's attached to the words. The source, the source, the source. You want to reign as a king? You're going to have to be under the king. You're going to have to know his nature, not just his name, his nature. His name and his nature match. Matter of fact, demons' names and nature match. Is a dumb spirit smart? No, it's dumb, right? Is a hasty spirit patient? No, it's hasty, right? Its name and its nature match. All of the names of God were for you to identify with the nature of Jesus. But you can't be more spiritual than your emotions allow you. It's EQ, not IQ, in the days ahead. And Jesus walks through walls, and whether they're your own making or somebody put them on you somehow and you took it, you need to get rid of all walls. The only legitimate wall in your life is the peace of God. If the peace of God, which guards your heart and your mind, you realize how safe you are? You're not only safe, but you're militant. Peace is guarding your heart. Love on the inside precedes peace, and peace precedes your spiritual worldview. You'll have the heart of Jesus. You'll have the eyes of Jesus. Love precedes peace. Peace precedes your perception and the way you see the life around you, and the love of God's flowing. How many are going to take, we're going to get this written up and have you test yourself on a daily basis to a love challenge. How long can you just walk open? And wouldn't you like to just have this stuff simplified in a little chart and test yourself, how much did you love with your life this week? We're going to do that, right, Jennifer? This is the love challenge. To reign as kings in life is going to be how much did you love with your life is really what it amounts to, right? Well, let's pray right now. If anything got stirred up, any barriers, any misconceptions, we're asking right now that the Jesus in us, right now, I drop down to my spirit and I'm saying, you know, I do this and I complain or I murmur or I do this or I put up walls with certain people or I block this, I block that. I want Jesus to walk through walls today, and he lives in you, and he can go through any wall. And don't ever come up to me and say, I'm stuck. Because when you're saying you're stuck, that means that you stopped it, not Jesus. Jesus walks through the walls. That means part of you wants to and part of you don't. For heaven's sakes, the new creation you wants to. Agree with the part of you that wants to go through walls. So Father, right now, by the power of the Holy Spirit, you're quickening people and circumstances to these people's minds right now. You're showing them individuals, people watching by Ustream. You're seeing people and individuals and circumstances that you've got walls up, and there is no legitimate wall in the Lordship of Jesus. He is the only wall, and he walks through all those other walls and replaces that wall with his supernatural peace that'll guard your heart and your mind through Christ Jesus. So Father, right now, I let Jesus, the forgiver in me, I fling open the gates of my heart, and I let forgiveness flow to whatever forgiveness or release, depending on the issue. Wherever there's walls in my life, my Jesus is walking through those walls. And once he walks through those walls, he leaves behind a residue of his peace that guards my heart and my mind. And the flow of love is continually flowing out. It doesn't end with forgiveness. It doesn't end, but it simply unclogs the pipe so that love can flow now. Love is flowing constantly and continually after I forgive. After I forgive, I'm a walking intercessor, because the love of God is flowing out of my belly, flows rivers of living water, constantly, increasingly, more and more and more. There's people, if they're watching by Ustream, there's people that you need to forgive, pastors. You need to forgive Christians in the church. You need to forgive the church in general. For no matter what hurt you've faced, the solution is God's only got one plan, and it's the church of Jesus. It's his bride. And you need to release forgiveness through that wall, that barrier that you put up with Christians, that barrier you put up with the church at large, that barrier, let it flow. It doesn't mean you're going to reconcile with all of them. Some people don't want to reconcile, but you have an obligation to let forgiveness flow. Reconciliation takes two people. Reconciliation requires repentance on behalf of the other individual. If they don't repent, you forgive unilaterally. You release forgiveness. You are free of the torment. You have uncapped that flow, that greatest force in the universe, the love of God flowing out of your heart. Nothing can stop that flow but you. Out of my heart flows the issues of life. There is a river that makes glad the city of God. Out of the base of my temple flows rivers of living water, and wherever those rivers of living water flow, it brings forth life. It brings life wherever it flows. Ezekiel 47. Thank you, Jesus. My temple doors are wide open. My temple doors are open day and night. And the light, the life, and the love of God is going to flow as a continuous river. How many want to accept that challenge to love continuously, unhindered, consistently constant as a flow? And God, cause my conscience to be extremely sensitive to shutting down or putting up a wall in any way, shape, or form. And let the love of God flow. And from that place of love flowing, I will have wisdom. Because the wisdom that comes from above needs purity. It is first of all pure, peaceable, full of mercy and good fruit. If any of you lack wisdom, ask. But God's going to say, if you want wisdom, it's going to be out of the purity of the heart. The wisdom from above is pure. I want to receive forgiveness for manipulation in any way, shape, or form. Manipulation is of the devil. I said, let your yes be yes, your no be no. Anything else is from the evil one. I don't need worldly wisdom. I need the wisdom that comes from above, that is pure, peaceable, full of mercy, good fruits. We're asking God for the wisdom of application. Teach us in the days ahead how to live a replaced life. Cause us to move from the level of that God is for us to a well depth of knowledge of God is in us. And then God translate it into an even further development of God through us into the greater works, into the destiny that we were called to. In Jesus' name.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.
Did you know that we have an online school available? Hi, I'm Pastor Jason Clark. We invite you to join our international community of almost 1,000 students currently enrolled in a school like no other. Team Embassy equips believers to live in the Spirit by giving them the how-to tools for wholeness, intimacy with God, and living the abundant life Jesus promised us. You'll learn how to heal emotional pain quickly and completely. You'll discover amazing keys to tap into the fruit of the Spirit and practice the presence of God as a lifestyle. Exciting courses available include the 60-Day Challenge, Self-Deliverance, Healing Rejection, Codependency, Intimate Prayer, the functions of the human spirit, and many, many more. It's formatted so that you could take it with you on all your mobile devices. Sign up today at training.teamembassy.com. Be transformed. Become all God created you to be. You will never be the same.